Joining us right now is former Goldman Sachs partner Peter Kiernan, also a Donald Trump supporter. Peter, good to see you.
Great to be with you.
Thank you so much for joining us. So oil, first, were you surprised by this incredible move in the last 4 months?
Well, not really. When you look at what's been going on, oil has been facing two problems that have caused the price to rise, which is disruption, which has been transient and more permanent in some cases, and retreat. And the combination of those two factors means we've probably got 3 million or a little bit more than that of typical supply that's not available. No one would have predicted that oil would go up 90% in 90 days. But the fact is we have elements of our supply which are under duress, and that's causing the price to go up.
What are you expecting out of OPEC today?
OPEC will try very hard to come up with a ceiling or a cap. The one thing I would say is if you look at history, it's more like a rubber band than a cap. This is a ceiling that has been routinely exceeded over the years. But I think with Iran's intransigent to be watched, I think they may try once again to create some sort of ceiling. My bet is it's above the 30 or so million barrels and goes up to 32 or 33.
Peter, I'm glad you brought up OPEC, because one of the things that's happening is that every member nation in there is operating with their own self-interest, and they have been. And so that's why the price of oil has been doing what it's been doing, especially when it's come down. Now, when it comes down to the price of oil, do you think there's a big overhang on the price around the $50 barrel? Because I look at the producers here in the United States, and they've modeled out $50. So they'll sell as much of it as they can at $50 to continue operations. So do you see a big price move up from here, or are we going to stay in this range?
Well, you brought up something that I think is really important. Oil is not molybdenum. Oil has, yes, supply, demand, and people who speculate, but it has one more thing that characterizes it. It is a matter of national destiny. So if you're Iran, you're not gonna pump 3.5 million barrels a day. You used to be at 4 and higher, so these nations are going to continue. Venezuela cannot stop pumping. Their economy is melting down. They've got an oil for loan deal with China. So what you're going to have is continued supply. I think this notion that we're going to see oil spike from here is misjudgment. I think what we're going to see is some moderation. Some of disruption, like oil fires in Canada, they can be put out. They can solve Kuwaiti strike issues. But nothing in Nigeria is going to get better anytime soon. And I think Iran is going to pump.
What about Libya?
Yeah, go ahead.
What about Libya?
Libya is one of those things where it'll be episodically improved. It's not as bad as Nigeria. But when you have people in your nation who want to disrupt your oil supply, when you have a government under siege, as Libya is, I would expect you'll see moments of greatness from Libya in terms of production, followed by interruption that's more transient. And so I think there's going to be a lot of volatility around Libya.
Do you see any chance, really, for there to be a consensus, though, at OPEC, you know, with the proxy wars going on between Saudi Arabia and Iran, with Iran's markets just opening, as you mentioned, wanting to continue to pump? I mean, what's the chance for a real consensus?
Well, I think unless Iran can be brought to somehow play ball, there will be no consensus. And as recently as yesterday, the deputy oil minister of Iran said, we have no plans to cut our production. I have to say, if you look at Iran's production, I'm sure you agree with this if you're watching it, their return to production has been nothing short of extraordinary. They were under a bell jar for a very long time. Back in the 70s, they used to produce 4 million barrels a day. They're back to 3.5. They have no intention of stopping until they get to 4 million barrels a day and beyond. This is a matter of economic destiny.
It used to be the Saudis that would say, we're doing whatever we want. We're going to continue. And then, you know, they allowed prices to plummet because they would not cut production. Now it's Iran.
Well, it's very interesting. Saudis still sit in a very important position, just as you say. Iran is sort of a face-off. It's a little bit of a Cold War III when you look at the way these two interact. But Saudis have a problem. They ran a $100 billion deficit last year, and they have to fund that. Secondly, they have now slipped into the number three defense spending nation in the world, $65 billion a year. So there's $165 billion. Nut that they're going to have to cover this year.
Sure.
They have no intention. You can disguise it as we're going for market share. It's a matter of national well-being. There's one other thing. 70% of the people who live in Saudi Arabia are under 30, and a huge proportion of them are underemployed or unemployed. That is a petri dish for problems that Saudi Arabia does not want. Now, watch for them to keep pumping.
That's the situation across the Mideast, right? All of these young people. We want to move on to Trump, because you're a Donald Trump supporter. Trump and Hillary Clinton going back and forth over the economy, the future of the country. This is in speeches taking place. Listen to this. I want to get your reaction.
Since Bill Clinton signed an agreement to put China into the World Trade Organization, you know about that catastrophe, Sacramento has lost nearly 1 in 5 manufacturing jobs. Great going. Listen to this one. Hillary Clinton, when she was Secretary of State, ran up $1 trillion in trade deficits with China. $1 trillion. Great job, Hillary. Hillary, a great job, Hillary. You're doing a great job. Great people working hard, can't get jobs. You know, that 5% is it's a sham. It's a total sham. That was put there so that presidents look better. Your real number is close to 20%. And if it wasn't, despite the fact you like me on the military and the border and all that, we wouldn't have crowds like this every place I go.
Trump and his employees took advantage of vulnerable Americans, encouraging them to max out their credit cards, empty their retirement savings, destroy their financial futures. He is trying to scam America the way he scammed all those people at Trump U.
It's going to be some summertime, Peter. What do you think about that?
Not exactly the summer of love.
No, summer of discontent.
Yes, absolutely. Listen, I think as it relates to China, we're in a codependency with China. They provide us finance, and we need to borrow about 40% of what we spend as a nation every year, and China is only too willing to provide that lending to us right now. I would say that where Trump is right is that we have been ineffective in negotiating really arm's length with China.
Why?
Well, I think part of it is China has spent every moment understanding everything they can about us.
Yeah.
And you think about when I was a boy, I had the finest minds in the country, Brzezinski, Kissinger, George F. Kennan, watching every twist and turn of the Soviet Union, really understanding the Soviets. Who's doing that for China today in our government? Who are the people on the Sentinel, on the post, watching how China's emerging, how they're trading, how they're changing? We do not have a government that is sufficiently fluent in the dealings of Japan, of China, and if you go into a tough negotiation with someone who knows much more about you than you know about them, you're going to get the results.
Shouldn't
that
be the global economy as well be worried about China? Because if we go back to 1999, we used to be 50% of the world's GDP. We're only 25% now here in the United States. And we saw what happened last summer. They devalued their currency, the yuan, right? And it sent the global markets into turmoil. So shouldn't it also be the EU focusing on China, how to deal with that, and other countries?
Well, I would say the EU is another major counterparty. They haven't gotten a coordinated, consolidated view of China. And while China has been doing this, we go back to oil for a second. Look what China has done on oil. Iran, the Saudis, Venezuela, their number one oil trading partner, China. China, if you want to follow China's foreign policy, follow their checkbook. They've been much more effective. Forget guns. They're using their checkbook. Mm. We have to have a much more sophisticated global approach commercially if we're going to compete with China.
Yeah. Great points, Peter. Really great. Thank you so much for joining us.
Great to be with you.
Peter
Thanks.
Peter Kernan there joining us.
And happy anniversary.
Thank you so much. It's been a great year for all of us. Thank you very much, Peter.